Now, if you're going to be doing single subject research, your design must include three important features. First of all, we are going to be measuring a single person, so you're going to have to be taking multiple measurements of that person over time. So you're tracking that person over time, repeating those measurements. That's the first feature. The second feature is that we're going to be measuring this person under different kinds of conditions, what we would call different phases. So you have like the treatment phase and the control phase and so on. So that's the second feature. And the third feature is that the way you decide when to switch one from one phase to the next is based on how the data looks. So we commonly use what's called the stable or the steady state strategy. And that just means when we're looking at the data for a particular phase, we want to wait until it kind of levels out, until it kind of normalizes. And once it does form a nice, you know, straight line-ish, then that would indicate it's time to switch to the next phase. So here's an example of some data that you might hope to get if you do a single subject design. So here you see we've got these three phases, A and then B and then back to A. And here's what your data might end up looking like. Now, as you can see, the A's are both lower than the B's. And while they don't form a nice, perfectly straight line, they do seem to kind of level out over the number of trials that we've included here. If we included even more trials, it'd probably be even more of a straight line. So like I said, that's the kind of data you would hope to get if you did a single subject design. But I should probably go back a little bit and be a little bit more descriptive about some important key terms here, like the term phases, for example. So a phase, that just refers to a series of observations of the same individual under the same conditions. So typically we use the letter A for the baseline. Now that's like the control condition, the no treatment condition. And then we use the letter B for the treatment condition. You know, that's when we're manipulating the participant in some way. So when it comes to single subject design, if I tell you that I did an ABA design, then that means I had a baseline followed by a treatment, and then I went back to baseline. So it's very easy to convey how your single subject design was set up simply by mentioning how many A's and how many B's and what order they were in. But you can get a lot more nuanced than that. You can include more letters for different kinds of treatments. Like if you want to talk about different versions of a single treatment, you could just give them numbers like B1, B2, B3, so on. But if you want to talk about completely different kinds of treatments that have, you know, nothing in common, then you can just use more letters. So you can have like A, you know, that's your baseline, followed by B, that's your treatment, and then C, that's a different treatment, and then D, that's a third treatment, and so on. So just in general, if you want to talk about different versions of a single treatment, you put a little number on it. So like B1, B2. But if you want to talk about completely different treatments, you just use any letter that's not A, basically. Now, something else I mentioned is that you're obviously going to need to change from one phase to the next, and the way you decide when to change is based on the data. So I just wanted to say a little bit more about that. When you do a phase change, what you are generally doing is you're either administering or stopping some treatment. And the whole purpose of a phase change is to show that you can add or remove a treatment. And adding or removing that treatment will have an effect on the participant's behavior. In a manner of speaking, you want to be able to show that you can turn on or turn off this treatment effect. And as I said earlier, there's no real previously set point at when you should do this. It's based on how the data looks. Careful observation of the data will let you know when it's the most appropriate time to change your phase. Now, one popular single subject research design is called the reversal design, or ABAB, or full reversal. And it's exactly what it sounds like. It's a single subject design consisting of a baseline, followed by a treatment, then return to a baseline, and then return to the treatment. So, literally, it's A, B, A, B. Very simple. This is not complicated stuff, but this is a very popular design, and it's an important one to remember because this is the kind of classic design you would see when it comes to all kinds of, like, psychotherapeutic and even medical kinds of treatment designs. The goal of going from A to B and then back to A and then back to B is to show that you can turn on and off. Just like with a light switch, you could turn on and off these effects. Because if you really think about it, if you go from baseline to treatment, that, and there's a difference there, that will show that something interesting is happening, but it's not conclusive evidence that that change is due to your manipulation. So by going back to baseline, if you then observe the treatment go away, the effect go away, then that is seem much more compelling. And then if you go back to treatment and the effect comes back again, that is very powerful evidence that you are actually having an influence here. So here's an example of what I was just trying to describe. So if this is what your data looks like after doing your ABA design, that looks very convincing. See, during the baselines, the participant's performance is lower than in the treatments. And those A's are consistent and the B's are consistent, so it seems clearly, these changes that we can see in the data seem clearly to be due to which phase the participant's in. It's not some extraneous variable. There's no confounds that could easily describe what's going on here. Now, there are many different kinds of the ABAB design. You know, it seems very simple, but there's actually a lot that you can do with it. Like you could, for example, include different versions of a treatment. So you could have a treatment B, and then version 1, and version 2, and version 3, and so on. Or you can include other kinds of treatments as well, like treatment C, or D, and so on. And now, but if you really think about it, the number of potential phase sequences is unlimited. But in order for them to be a true experimental design, they have to meet certain requirements. In order to be considered a true experimental design, you have to unambiguously demonstrate a cause-effect kind of relationship. And the way we would do that is perhaps best explained in this example. So let's say you're a researcher and you have clearly, you've established a clear pattern during your baseline phase. So you have a nice stable state during your baseline. At that point, you decide it's time to switch to treatment. So you go to phase B, but nothing happens. You know, you switch from A to B and the data doesn't change. So your treatment doesn't seem to have any effect. So you decide to try a different treatment. You use a different version of treatment B. So you use B1 in this case. But that still doesn't show an effect. So now we go straight to a completely different kind of treatment. Let's call it treatment C. Now we get an effect. Something is interesting. You know, the data finally changes. After going from A to B to B1 and now finally C, finally we see a difference. But that's not good enough. Now we need to be able to, now that we've turned on that effect, we need to be able to turn it off and turn it back on again. That's the whole idea of this ABAB, or full reversal. So what we'll want to do in this case is, like I said, try to turn it off. So we observe this effect in C, so we go back to baseline, and we effectively turn it off. Now we go back to C, and in this particular case, it doesn't turn back on again. So somehow we turned it on, and then we turn it off, but now we're having trouble turning it on again. It's a little bit confusing as to what's going on here. So you really just need to kind of look closely at the data, try every possible combination, and in this particular case, you might find that the treatment effects you observed were only due to the combination of B1 and C. So you have to have both of those to get the treatment effects. As you can see, it can be a bit confusing, but the whole idea of all of this reversal design is that you want to be able to turn it on, turn it off, and then turn it back on again. If you can demonstrate that capability, then you are providing some really compelling evidence that your treatment does have effectiveness. Now, another design that is pretty popular is called the alternating treatments design, or discrete trials design. And this is used for different kinds of research. Now, in alternating treatments design, two or more treatment conditions are randomly alternated from one observation to the next. The result is a series of observations representing a corresponding series of alternating treatment conditions. And in order to be able to do this, it has to be possible for the researcher to switch randomly between the two. So if you think back to the ABAB design, we have a series of, you know, observations forming phase A. Then when it stabilizes, we go to a series of observations for phase B, wait for that to stabilize, and then we go back to A, and so on. But with alternating treatments, we don't do that. We just go one observation at A, one at B, one at A, one at B, A, B, A, B, A, B, like that. So it's literally, it goes alternating like that. And in order for to be able to do this, like I just illustrated, you have to be able to switch quickly between the two. And you don't always have to go A, B, A, B. You could have multiple A's, multiple B's, but the whole idea here is you should be able to like randomly alternate between the two. In order for this to be an effective design for your study, the treatment has to be able to be turned on and turned off immediately. Can't have any kind of delayed effect here. And then a third design that's used in single subject research is called multiple baseline. Now this is used for the kind of research where you wouldn't want to go back to baseline again. Like once you switch from baseline to treatment, for some reason you won't want to go back. So what this design does is it actually involves multiple single subjects. So we have two or more single subjects that are measured at baseline. Then one of them enters a treatment phase while the other one is kept at baseline. And then at a later point, the other one enters the treatment. So like, here's our two little participants. We measure them both at baseline, and then one of them is then put into treatment, and the other one will continue to be at baseline and then put into treatment later on. So the big benefit to doing this kind of design is that you only have to change phase once. And as I was saying earlier, there's a reason why you would want to do that. The reason why you would not want to go back to baseline is, well, just for example, maybe you're a medical researcher and you're trying to develop a cure for cancer. If you give that cancer treatment to a patient and they start to show signs of improvement, you'd have to be a terrible person to take it away just because you want to measure their baseline again. Like, no, you're not going to take that treatment away. If that treatment seems to even maybe be working, they need to keep receiving the treatment. So yeah, that's the big benefit to doing a multiple baseline, is you don't have to take away the treatment that might be helping someone. So here's what your data might look like. This is like optimal data for a multiple baseline design. So you see participant one, we measure them at baseline, and then we measure them during treatment. And then for participant two, we have an extended baseline and then a treatment. And as you can see, This data seems to clearly show it doesn't matter when you switch to treatment. By switching to treatment, the participant's data shifts downwards. So there seems to be pretty clear treatment effect in this case. And there's what I just explained is the most classic kind of multiple baseline design, but there's variations on this. Like you have the multiple baseline across subjects, that's what I was just describing. That's where you have, you know, two single subjects that you're comparing. But you could also do multiple baseline across behaviors. So you could look at a single individual and compare two different behaviors that they perform. Same idea as what I was just describing, but now it's with two behaviors of a single person. Or you could do multiple baseline across situations. So now we're looking at the same behavior, but in different situations. Like maybe measure them once at home, and then you measure them at school or at the workplace or whatever, but you're just comparing these different situations for the same person. So that's the whole idea of multiple baseline design, is you just want to be able to enter into treatment without having to go back to baseline.